go ahead and get started with this week's case study. And before we get started, we'll do the case study just a little bit different, I think. And usually with the technical webcasts, we wait until about 20, maybe 30 minutes into the presentation and stop and open up the lines for questions. With the case study, I think in order to keep the flow going, because we got a lot of material to cover, we're just going to kind of roll through until we get closer to the end of the hour, and then we'll stop for a large question and answer where we'll open up the lines. But please, if you have questions while I'm going through the presentation, I'll do my best to keep my eyes on the question box section on your GoToWebinar panel where you can type in questions. And if it's something that I can get to while I'm explaining or walking through a particular strategy, and it helps with, and I think it's going to be a good question to answer for the rest of the audience. It'll be good information for them. And then I'll try to answer them as we're going through the presentation. If I don't get a chance to answer it as we roll through the presentation, we'll answer it at the very end, or we can answer it after the webcast if we really run out of time. So our family this week are the Carter family. So we've got Jerry and Susan Carter. Both are 63. They own and operate a very profitable manufacturing business in a small town. This business in particular is really a source of economic strength for their small town. So it's important that this business continue to operate, especially through the recession. So as a result, for the last 4 or 5 years, they've really been putting a lot of their profit from the business back into the business. Just about every year, they're taking all the excess company profits and putting it back in. And they actually also loaned about $9 million to the business in order to keep it operating successfully through the last 4 or 5 years. They do spend a fair amount. They spend about $350 a year in living expenses just on themselves, and then they've got an additional $200,000 in gifts to their family and another additional $150 to their favorite charitable causes. The gifting to family and charities are usually dependent on how well the business is doing, but since it's been very successful lately, those are two things that they enjoy giving to. So Jerry and Susan have pretty much hit a point in their life where Susan's already gone out and she has started her own venture for something else in the community that that's very near and dear to her heart. And Jerry's kind of been running the business himself along with their new CEO. And Jerry's pretty much hit a point where he wants to exit the business and step out and help Susan and the rest of their family and other community causes that that they have interest in, and that's very close to their hearts. So he's really looking for a way to start exiting the business, and he's kind of already started to do that. He started passing it on to a new CEO, as I mentioned, that's in the business, and they've also got some other key managers in place to ensure that the company continues operating successfully even after he exits from the day-to-day. There's really no interest in selling to a third party because of the company's effect on their small town and their love for their community. They want to make sure that the business stays in town as a way to continue keeping the community operating. And also, they've decided it's about time that they start to, the company's now been successful and survived the recession, and as a result, they really want to start taking some money out of their business. So when we talked to them, we asked them what was the number they thought they were comfortable in pulling out from the company every year. And that number he came back with was about $1 million. He said he could probably go a little bit higher, but it was going to cause a little bit of unease. So he came back and said, I would be comfortable taking out about $1 million a year in excess profit from the company. So keep that number in the back of your mind as we go through our presentation today. The family's already done a little bit of planning prior to coming to us. Their attorney, who is continuing to work with us on the case, has already done asset protection for the family. They set up a holding LLC to own various business interests. This business, Carter Manufacturing, is a subchapter S corporation. Jerry also has another small S corporation that he owns and operates, very small. And so those two companies, along with a another limited liability company that that holds their the ground that their business operates on, those are all held inside of that holding company. And then they also have a family partnership that holds this $9 million note receivable that they have from money that they lent to the company. It also has a cash and securities account with quite a bit of money in it, and also some land and equipment for their farmland, all owned inside that family partnership. And then the family partnership and the holding LLCs are both wholly owned by asset protection trusts, which Jerry and Susan own. In terms of assets, two-thirds of Jerry and Susan's wealth is comprised of Carter Manufacturing. So they have about a $60 million net worth. About $40 million of that is held in the company. Another $9 million of that is held in a note receivable from the company. So right there you can see there's basically $50 million of their net worth is tied up in the company in one way or another. They also have about $2 million in commercial real estate where the company holds its offices, and another $5 million in cash and securities. They also have some personally owned life insurance, some VULs, and some whole life policies totaling $9.5 million. Again, they own that personally. The primary planning goals here are to provide for the financial security of the surviving spouse if one of them predeceases the other, maintain Carter Manufacturing as a viable company in their hometown after the exit of the business. This was a big deal. Maintain customary lifetime gifting and living expenses of $650,000 a year. Eliminate or reduce estate taxes. Maintain adequate gifting to their children and grandchildren. That's that $200,000 a year number. And their primary focus is to make sure that they can successfully fund their grandchildren's education. They've got 4 kids and 10 grandchildren right now. So they have a lot of family members to take care of, that they feel that they need to take care of. Maximize the inheritance they leave to their children and grandchildren. And they also were really interested in establishing a family foundation for their lifetime and future family charitable giving. So now we'll go ahead, we'll jump into the plan. And where we're going to start today is we're going to start by looking at just a brief summary of what we're going to be talking about and proposing to the family. So you can see here, this is our periodic table of estate planning elements. So everything that you see in yellow are planning techniques and strategies that the family's already implemented. They already have their revocable living trusts. They have that asset protection trust that I mentioned already. They have a family limited partnership as well as a holding LLC. And those items right there in that column right here all add up to a load of asset protection for the family, which several years ago was really their main concern. Now the company's become more profitable. They want to exit the business. They feel better about the company's ability to sustain itself. So this is where we started looking at items that you're going to see in green. Okay, so 529 plans, funding for their grandchildren's future education was really important to them. Gifting, this has to do with utilizing their lifetime exemption right now. Sale for an installment note, GDOTs, which are grantor deemed owner trusts, and dynasty trusts, that's all one and the same as far as the strategies go. So that's something that if you've seen our cases before, you're familiar with. If you haven't, we're going to talk in great detail about them. Those are great ways to hold the family inheritance and reduce estate taxes. They also provide another element of asset protection. We also have GDOT owned life insurance, a captive insurance company in here. And then in terms of charitable techniques, we have something called a TCLAT, or a testamentary charitable lead annuity trust. We'll talk about that as we get towards the end of our presentation today. The Carter Family Foundation, which they are really excited about moving into, and also retirement plans, annuities, any kind of qualified asset to charity at death. So the first thing that we're going to jump into is we're going to move into the results from the planning. So the first thing we focus on is their liquidity and their assets during life. One of the things that you see a lot of clients get stuck on early on is you start talking to them about all these great ideas of taking assets and moving them outside of their estate and setting them up for their children's inheritance. And you have to remember when you're talking to these families that you're basically talking about clients who have probably spent the vast majority of their life either building or starting and building their own business. And they don't want, while they do want to provide for their children and their grandchildren if it's applicable, they also want to know what's in it for them. They don't want you to take all these assets out of their hands that they've spent their entire lives building. They don't want to see you just take them out of their hands and them not be able to reap the benefits of those. So we start with the liquid assets, the assets that would be able to sustain their lifestyle needs during life, and we focus on that first. So what are they going to have still available to them during life, assuming that the whole plan that we propose to them is implemented? So you can see here, this is their green area over an extended period of time. These are readily liquid assets available to them over life. So these are primarily cash, securities, annuities, retirement funds, corporate and municipal bonds. And then you can see here on top, we've got another additional blue shaded area. And we talked about that $9 million note receivable that they have from the business. Okay, so while it's not a readily liquid asset, this is an asset that could be used, if needed, to provide additional liquidity over time and into the future through means of the company paying off that that note that they have that is due to Jerry and Susan. Along the same lines of focusing on the family's liquidity and their living expenses and available cash flow during life, our next step is to take a look at what are the proposed living expenses as against the proposed annual cash flow, and where is that cash flow coming from? Okay, so you can see here for an extended period of time, our green line is either going to be right at or just above their living expenses over time. Okay, at a certain point you can see there is a drop-off. The drop-off in the living expenses is a revocation of the grantor status of our irrevocable trust. We'll talk about that, why we're doing it, why it's happening, and how it's happening. We'll talk a little bit more about it. You can see here there's also a dip in the green line. That's because when we revoke the grantor status, we would have already paid off the entire note due to the family. So it probably sounds a little bit confusing right now, but don't worry, we are going to talk about it. The next thing that we looked at that was really important to this family is, even though they were willing to begin pulling funds out of the business and not reinvest every single dollar of the company's profits back into the company, we talked about that $1 million number. Okay, they were okay with taking $1 million of profit out. So if the company's running at about $5 million in annual profits right now, if they decide to take out $1 million of that, that would leave them with about $4 million in profit that they wanted to see going back into the company every year. And you're going to see it growing because their profits are expected to inflate and grow over time, as is the value of the business. So they wanted to know that no matter what we proposed to them in our plan, that they were always going to be reinvesting at least as much as they would have if they did nothing. Okay, so the orange bars that you see here on this chart resemble what they would have been reinvesting back into Carter Manufacturing every year if all they did was take $1 million in excess profits out. The green line is what they are going to be reinvesting into the company every single year under our proposed plan. Okay, so the key here was really to focus on the first 5 to 10 years to make sure that our green line was either at or slightly above the amount of money that they would have reinvested if they had done no planning whatsoever. Okay, and we'll talk about why that green line is a little bit above the orange as we get further along in the proposed strategies. Okay, then from a result standpoint, then after we've shown them what's going to happen with their assets and to them personally during life, we wanted to take a look at what we are going to be creating in terms of a inheritance for their children, a charitable gift at death, and either a reduction or an elimination of estate taxes. So once we focused on them, then we changed focus to what do the kids get, what does the government get in the means of taxes, and what does the charity get with a proposed strategy. So the first thing we did is we take a look at what happens if they implement the entire plan in year number one and then they die on the 31st day of this year. What happens? Okay. Now, overall, the children could receive a greater inheritance. Okay. This deferred inheritance we're talking about here is the deferred inheritance from a TCLAT, which we'll talk more about. Okay, so year number one, the numbers might not look terribly impressive other than the fact that we have a huge gift to charity created and we've completely eliminated the estate taxes, and we're looking, this immediate inheritance to heirs is only slightly reduced. Okay, so if this were a turnoff, we took a look at what it would look like for the kids and to charity and to taxes if we took that TCLAT out, we took that deferred inheritance out. Okay, so now we have a very significant inheritance advantage for the kids and the grandkids and a little bit of a reduction in estate taxes, but a much smaller amount passing to charity. Then we move on to the very last year of our plan. So this would be the IRS joint table life expectancy of Jerry and Susan. Okay, so here we've created an inheritance to heirs immediately of $172 million advantage. Okay, we've also created a $35 million plus gift to charity at death and eliminated their estate taxes. Okay, this is just a graph that resembles basically what we just saw in the last few summary pages, but this shows it year over year. The red line being the current plan, what would pass to the family, the green line being what would pass to the family under their proposed plan with life insurance, and the blue line what would be being what would pass to the family without life insurance. And these don't include any possible deferred inheritance from the TCLAT remainders, mostly because of the speculative nature of those. We'll talk all about that as we get into that particular strategy. So now we'll go ahead and we'll jump into the individual strategy breakdowns. Okay, so the first strategy that we have is what we call grantor deemed owner trusts. Okay, if you've never heard this term, it's the exact same thing as an intentionally defective grantor trust. We just like to call them by a different name. So basically, for estate planning purposes, any assets owned inside of these trusts are going to be outside of their estates for estate tax purposes, but during the duration of the grantor status of these trusts, any taxable income that flows through those trusts is going to pass back to Jerry and Susan as the grantors of those trusts. So when we start looking into assets owned inside the trust, we want to make sure that Jerry and Susan have sufficient personal cash flow to cover any income tax liability created by assets owned inside the trust. Okay, and when we talk to the families about these trusts, we also like to talk to them about the fact that they can be set up as dynasty trusts, and that can provide long-term asset protection and estate tax savings for not just them, but future generations. Okay, and when we talk about our planning, we like to build in as much flexibility as possible And we start to talk about having Susan as a discretionary beneficiary of Jerry's trust. Okay, and this allows for discretionary distributions out to Susan in order to either cover a one-time or a periodic income tax liability, or if maybe they just want to go out and they just need a chunk of money at one particular point in time or periodically. It's not something, this discretionary power is not something that you want to exercise every year, because you don't want to call it into, you don't want to bring it into the ire of the IRS. Okay, the next thing that we're going to do is we're going to have, remember, Carter Manufacturing is a sub-S corporation, okay, and it's owned inside of a holding LLC called Carter LLC. So we're going to have Carter LLC transfer $2 million worth of its interest in Carter Manufacturing Incorporated to Jerry and Susan's individual GDOTs. So Jerry and Susan are, in essence, essentially going to be utilizing $2 million apiece of their annual, or pardon me, of their lifetime gift exemption. Okay. One of the questions I know we're going to get is, why aren't you utilizing all of their lifetime exemption right now today, while it's at $5 million plus apiece, $5.12 million to be specific per individual? The question I'm sure we're going to get is, why aren't we using all of that $5 million exemption? And when it boils down to it, this is where having an understanding and having a cash flow model helps you understand what is possible and what isn't possible in the realm of advanced planning. Okay, so from a cash flow standpoint, we can't simply take $5 million of this business and gift it to a trust that's a grantor trust. Okay, because then we're going to have too much taxable income inside of that grantor trust that flows back to Jerry and Susan as grantors that they have to pay income tax on, but we're not going to have enough income coming back from the trust, enough cash flow coming back from the trust to Jerry and Susan to cover that income tax liability. So really, we couldn't look at simply gifting their maximum amount and then worrying about it later. We had to find the right balance between a gift and a sale. And that's what we're going to talk about next, is what's the right amount, what can we sell to those trusts? Okay, so for those of you who have done work with us before or seen our case studies before, you're probably wondering why there's no S corporation recapitalization and there's no appraisal of non-voting interests for evaluation adjustments that we can sell at a lower value, okay? And that's basically because we wanted to sell at the highest value possible for this company for cash flow purposes. Okay, we got a company that cash flows, or that has company profits of $5 million a year that creates taxable income of $5 million a year back to the grantors. We had to make sure that the note payments were sufficient back to Jerry and Susan every year to cover their lifestyle expenses and their taxable income, their income tax liabilities generated from assets owned inside of this grantor trust. Okay, so the great thing about grantor trusts is their ability to create a tax burn effect on a taxable estate, but the problem is that sometimes with business owners who don't have a whole lot of personal wealth outside of their businesses, that tax burn effect can be a bad thing. Okay, it can be detrimental to the overall planning and overall goal of the family. So we found the right balance here. It happened to be that $4 million was what we could gift in the company interest, and then we sold the remaining $36 million in Carter Manufacturing to the GDOTs for an installment note. Okay, this installment note is going to provide annual and principal payments. The interest rate we're using at the time is going to be based on the long-term AFR. At this time, it was the long-term AFR for June of 2012 of 2.64%. So basically, every year, this note is designed to make interest payments based on the AFR used, and then it's going to make principal payments that are going to continue until the note is paid off. And those principal payments are basically going to fluctuate based on the cash flow we know needs to get back to Jerry and Susan. So in years where the company is not as successful, the principal payments are probably going to be lower. In years where the company is very successful and has higher company profits, those annual note payments are going to be higher, which is going to also change the amount of time it takes to pay down the full principal on the note. As it's illustrated in this plan, we're figuring that the note is probably going to be paid off entirely in 2025. These trusts have a toggle drafted into the language of the trust that basically allows the trust to have its grantor status revoked once. Okay, so come 2026, under this plan illustration, the grantor status is going to be revoked. This is going to relieve Jerry and Susan of the income tax liability from assets inside of the trust. Okay, so which was very important because basically once the note's paid off, we have nothing left to transfer cash flow back to Jerry and Susan in the event that they have excess income tax liability and lifestyle expense liability that's over and above what they are earning personally.
Hey, Kyle, this is Scott. Before you go on, and you may have said that, I might have missed it, but one of the things that also, just to go back on the valuation of the company, I heard you mention ESOP. There's a 10% ESOP here, and so to some degree, valuation of the interest retained by the owner is going to be controlled by the ESOP value, which of course has to be done every year. So oftentimes in a case that we work on, we're working with advisors and thinking about how do we create a discounting situation. In this particular case, we're a little bit limited already because we've got minority interest and lack of control discounts built into the ESOP valuation, and that's going to pretty much control our sale price and our gift price for the shares that are not owned by the ESOP, which, you know, in some cases makes the strategy even a little bit more solid from an audit point of view. So, okay, Kyle, I didn't mean to interrupt you. I just wanted to go back and catch that point.
No, that's helpful. Thanks, Scott. Thanks for chiming in. We also have another question that I'm going to go ahead and answer right now because this is the best time to answer it. The question is, does the GDOT become irrevocable once the grantor status is revoked? And actually, this is an irrevocable trust even while it's a grantor trust. So this is an irrevocable trust from day number one. The difference is that while it still has its grantor status, Jerry and Susan, as the grantors of the trust, are responsible for the income tax liability. And when we revoke the grantor status, they are no longer responsible for the income tax liability. Instead, the trust then become responsible for paying their own income taxes. So that's the difference there. It's an irrevocable trust the entire time. Excuse me. So the next thing that we're going to do is we're going to look at captive insurance companies. So this is a great way to basically pull money out of the company, defer income taxes to possibly lower income tax rates. It depends on what the capital gains rates are in the future and the dividend rates are in the future. And it also depends on when and how much money you pull out of the captives in the future. But basically, this creates an income tax deduction today, and it allows for pre-tax dollars to basically be saved inside of this vehicle into the future. And we're going to have the captive insurance company set up and owned inside of Jerry's GDOT. And then we're going to enter into basically insurance policies that are going to cover risks of loss of Carter Manufacturing Incorporated. So that premium is going to be paid from the cash flow of Carter Manufacturing. So instead of having $5 million in taxable profits, the company will actually have $4 million in taxable profits. That $1 million in premiums going to go into the captive insurance company, and it's basically going to be held there, and it's going to be invested in there. And this insurance company, this captive company, it is a legitimate insurance company. We won't get into the whole how the captives work, because that's a very detailed, long, drawn-out conversation. We actually, Scott already did a captive insurance company presentation earlier this year, I believe, that we have recorded in our database. We also have information on them on the website. But basically, this captive is going to create a deduction of $1 million a year for Carter Manufacturing Incorporated. And since Jerry and his trust are basically going to be the owners of this captive insurance company, any underwriting profits from the captive are going to be distributed out to the owner of the captive. They're going to be held inside the captive or distributed to Jerry's GDOT. Okay? So when Jerry and Susan said that they were willing to part with or pull out $1 million in $1 million in profit a year, if they had have basically only taken that $1 million out of the profits and then reinvested it themselves in their own cash or securities accounts, they would have had to pay ordinary income tax on that $1 million as it was pulled out of the company, like they do right now. Instead, we're going to take that million, we're going to defer paying income taxes on it, and we're going to go ahead and invest it into this captive insurance company. The other thing this is going to do is this is going to create a sizable account inside of this captive that's basically going to grow over time. And we see some clients use those to buy life insurance, large life insurance policies, and or create a pool for basically retirement savings for themselves. And that's exactly what we're doing here in this situation. Since we're saving roughly 40% on that $1 million, on that $1 million that we would have paid income taxes on, that leaves about $400,000 of additional cash flow that we can use for much needed life insurance. We already talked about the fact that this family has $50 million of their $60 million in net worth tied up in the business, whether it be directly through business value or through the note receivable of $9 million that they have from the company. So we're talking about a very illiquid company and family. And even though they have life insurance right now, about $9.5 million of life insurance, they had a need for more life insurance, not only to create liquidity at death, to pay it taxes, but rather in this particular situation, they had charitable interests in mind. So instead of paying estate taxes and needing the liquidity for that, they actually needed life insurance in order to help them with their charitable goals. So what we've proposed here is the GDOT owning a second-to-die life insurance policy of $32 million with $350,000 a year in annual premiums. And what we'll see here is that not only is this policy useful for wealth replacement that allows the family to give more charitably at death, but it also has a pretty good rate of return. And this is a guaranteed policy. So these are guaranteed rates of return, assuming that the premium is paid every single year. So you can see here, 2037, this is their joint IRS table life expectancy. They have a guaranteed return on this life insurance policy of 8.3%. And even if we take it out to their age 95, they still have a guaranteed after-tax return of 5.4%. So over and above the fact that they need liquidity, this is a pretty good investment tool as well if you really want to look at it in that manner. The next thing that we looked at was pretty big. It's from a grand plan scheme of things, it's very small, but was very important to Jerry and Susan because their grandchildren's education in their minds was most important, aside from planning for the business and sustaining that business. Planning for their grandchildren's educations was a really big deal. So we looked at 529 plans just as an added way to set up educational plans for the grandchildren going into the future. We basically assumed that they were making $50,000 a year in gifts for about 20 years into these 529 plans. So now that we've kind of covered all the strategies that are important to preserving the inheritance for the heirs, we needed to address their charitable interests. The first thing that we did, they've got a very small amount of money invested in retirement funds. These make great gifts to give to charity at the second death. They're great because we're basically eliminating a double tax. There's no estate tax on them when we give them to charity, and there's no income in respect to the decedent tax when we give them to charity. So they're really the most efficient asset to the charity. Since it doesn't happen until the second death, they retain control of those funds in the event of an emergency that they need to withdraw from those funds. The next thing that we looked at was a more significant charitable tool, and that's a testamentary charitable lead annuity trust, or a TCLAT. Again, this is another tool that does not get implemented until a second death, so they don't have to worry about giving too much to charity today and possibly running out of money in the future, because this won't take effect until the second death. But it passes a very large sum of money on to charity, and it reduces their estate taxes to zero. Okay, so basically what would happen here is all of the money remaining inside of their taxable estate at death, which in this particular situation, if they died today, would still be $56 million. Now, that's going to decrease over time as they pay down the note because we still have a very large note inside their estate right now, which is also another big reason the life insurance was really important. Because if they were to die, especially in the earlier years, they needed that liquidity from the insurance to be able to make this charitable contribution to the TCLAT. So we have this $56 million. It's going to go into a charitable trust. This charitable trust is going to make annual payments for 25 years to charity. Okay, so those charitable payments are going to be $2.6 million a year, totaling $66 million over that 25-year period. Okay, that annual payment, that is calculated based on the government's 75-20 rate. That 75-20 rate at the particular time of death is going to factor into the TCLAT payout rate right here. As you can see here, we're using really modest asset growth of 5% in that trust because we don't want to over-project any possible deferred inheritance. Okay, because at the end of those 25 years, if there is any amount remaining inside that charitable trust, any remainder amount, it's going to pass to the heirs. When we talk to the clients about it, though, we like to remind them that, A, this possible inheritance isn't going to happen until 25 years after they die, or if you decide to do a shorter term of the TCLAT, that particular term of years, it won't pay out until that particular term of years. The disadvantage of using fewer term of years for the TCLAT payouts is that it means the payout rate is going to be higher, which means that your assets inside of that charitable trust would have to earn more in order for there to be any remainder. And it all depends on how the market performs over that 25 years. There very well could be no remainder inside that charitable trust at the end of 25 years. So we like to prepare the family to set aside and plan in other ways using life insurance and those GDOTs to provide a sufficient inheritance for their heirs over and above and outside any possible deferred inheritance that would come from these TCLATs. Okay, so that wraps up the breakout of the strategies and the results. Everything you see here, the back half of the plan, those are all really detailed financials. All the numbers you see in those flowchart pages and results come from comparison of their existing financials and very detailed proposed and integrated financials. And those are all contained in the second half. We don't have enough time to run through them today. If you want, I know that we always make our presentations and our case studies available on our website. So if you want, you can go through them, look through them there at your leisure. And if you have questions about them, then please don't hesitate to call or email us